the Navy, that great bulwark of democracy. Hail to the ships and men who fight America's battles on the seven seas. Hail to the planes and pilots, too, who carry the fight to our enemies over land and sea from carrier deck and naval base. The fleet, afloat and awing, is the result of tradition. A fighting tradition instilled in its corps of officers at the U.S. Naval Academy at Annapolis. Here at the Navy's greatest shrine, the future officers learn the ideals of John Paul Jones, father of the American Navy, whose famous words, "I have not yet begun to fight," when his ship, Le Bonhomme Richard, was sinking in battle, gave new impetus to the American Revolution. Here they see and hear the story of American valor in the Barbary Wars and the Battle of Tripoli, and are steeped in the traditions of Truxton, Preble, and Decatur. That grand old flagship, the Constitution, old Ironsides, famous battle wagon of the early days of the nation. Commodore Oliver H. Perry's original handmade flag is here, which he flew on his flagship, the Lawrence, at the victorious Battle of Lake Erie. Reminders of that great Civil War naval fight between the Monitor and the Merrimac at Hampton Roads, Virginia, the first ironclads, which changed all naval history. Admiral Dewey, too, is in this Naval Hall of Fame, where our future naval officers can glory in his exploits aboard his flagship, the Olympia, at the Battle of Manila Bay. You may fire when you are ready, Gridley, another battle cry that has become history. And at Annapolis today, as an inspiration to new ranks of Middies, Dewey's own signal flags call again for freedom in the Philippines. Yes, rank after rank, these fine young men and thousands of others from civil life are consecrated to the ideals of America's fighting Navy and to the defense of our country. But all is not marching and drills or classroom work in the making of a naval officer. And the Navy starts him young. These youngsters are sons of naval officers stationed at the Naval Academy as instructors. And they're out to become junior commandos or else. From the ground up, as it were. Certain superstitions are a tradition of the sea. Here, the middies on their way to exams or before Army-Navy games throw pennies at old Tecumseh's statue for good luck. Good, clean sport is an important part in the naval officer's training. It fosters competition, fairness, and vigorous exercise. But no competition is quite so keen as the Navy's annual clash with the Army. Half the world, from the brass hats in Washington to blue jackets, doughboys, and marines in America's far-flung front lines, listen in to these classics.
The Navy today is a far cry from the wooden hulls of the days of John Paul Jones. The Navy's air service has ever been a leader in the science of aviation. It was our Navy that taught the world the terrific possibilities of dive bombing. Flying schools are turning out thousands of trained pilots, many of whom from the broad decks of our aircraft carriers have already written their names on the pages of history and fame, carrying death to our enemies in the Pacific, off Africa, and elsewhere.
In the submarine service, too, brave officers and courageous men are accomplishing wonders. In this, the most nerve-wracking and confining of all services, it takes men of steel. They never know when the hatch is closed whether they'll ever see daylight again. Every hand is against them, even friendly hands, until their identity is certain. Into the cold depths of the sea, cramped amid a maze of machinery, the men of the submarine service carry death for the enemy at their fingertips, but they themselves face constant disaster. We'll be right back.
times of peace, danger lurks in every dive of a submarine. The great submarine Squalus went down on a practice dive and stayed. Frantic rescue work by expert Navy divers, with the Navy's newly developed diving bell sent down to the stricken sub, saved a part of the crew. But for the remainder, they live in history. Underwater collisions have thus taken occasional toll of men in the submarine service. For days, sometimes, men trapped in submarines tap eager messages in code on the inert hulls of their craft as rescue work goes on.
As a result of the Navy's efficient salvage work, the Squalus finally was brought to the surface.
True to the tradition of the Navy, the reconditioned Squalus, now the Sailfish, has in her crew most of those rescued.
The crime of the century. Japan shows her cloven hoof in a sneak attack that transforms the USS Arizona into a blazing pyre and other Navy ships and shore installations to ruins. Undeclared war against a friendly nation in its worst form.
So it's war they want. And throughout the nation, young recruits burning with patriotism rush to enlist. A newer and bigger Navy in the making.
Girls and women, headed by the widows of Pearl Harbor, asked for jobs in plane and munitions plants. America's great war machine began to turn over more and more swiftly, speeded by women with a will to win.
From the first shot fired, the first bomb dropped. American naval officers and men showed the stuff that heroes are made of. And to many of them, Admiral Nimitz early proved their nation's gratitude in the form of medals for gallantry.
The Pacific soon became a one-way street, taking soldiers and Marines to the threatened areas in the Southwest Pacific. American fighting men in Navy convoy with only one idea in mind. Give us a chance to strike the Japs.
Meanwhile, America again became a nation of shipbuilders. Cargo ships, liberty ships, to span the oceans with supplies and munitions for our fighting forces and our allies. And warships, too, from subs to battleships, to give America a five-ocean navy, a navy without peer. More and more sea power, America's traditional need, now required to drive the Axis off the seven seas.
Another battle wagon to slug it out for Uncle Sam. Marines and sailors for the newer, bigger fleet, being hardened by experts such as Gene Tunney. Also, pre-flight training of the most rigorous kind, toughening up our future naval air fighters. But it seems they're all out of step but Jim.
This new commando type of training, which Army, Navy, and Marine Corps men are getting, guarantees alertness, stamina, and initiative. Without question, this training is turning out the best fighters in the world. They even learn how to survive in oil and flame-covered waters.
The Navy long has had lighter-than-air craft, and now it's paratroops. Yes, sir, sky sailors. And wherever they land, you just know the situation will be well in hand.
Speedy assault boats for landing parties have proved their worth in the Solomons and in North Africa.
Even tanks are taken ashore in special barges, the Navy's newest weapons.
U.S. Coast Guard, normally a separate service, becomes a part of the U.S. Navy. A highly valuable part.